Hello, my dear students. Today we are going to read a wonderful poem. The name of the poem is The Rime of the Ancient Mariner, written by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. This poem is from your English Literature Reader, Chapter 6. So let's get started. Let us know about the poet. Samuel Taylor Coleridge was an English poet, literary critic, philosopher, and theologian who, with his friend William Wordsworth, was a founder of the Romantic movement in England and a member of the Lake Poets. He also shared volumes and collaborated with Charles Lamb, Robert Southey, and Charles Lloyd. He wrote the poems The Rime of the Ancient Mariner and Kubla Khan, as well as the major prose work Biographia Literaria. Now let us read the poem. So first before we start this poem, let us give a short introduction to the poem. In this section of the poem, the mariner describes what happens after he shot the albatross. They feel the absence of the bird and express dismay in regards to the mariner's choice. The men try to justify what happened, suggesting that perhaps it actually brought them good luck. But unfortunately, the wind dies down and the calm sea becomes an omen of bad luck. The men are struck around water that they can't drink. The Rime of the Ancient Mariner is a lyrical ballad that is a poem written in the form and style of a folk ballad. Now let us know what is a ballad. The ballad is a narrative song poem, usually relating a single dramatic incident or story in a form suitable for singing or rhythmical chanting. Now let us read the poem. Stanza 1. The sun now rose upon the right, out of the sea came he, still hid in mist, and on the left went down into the sea. Here in the second part of the poem, The Rime of the Ancient Mariner by Samuel Taylor Coleridge, the weather has completely changed. The sun has appeared, although there is still a thick layer of mist in the air. Earlier it was foggy and misty, only with no trace of sun in the sky. The poet has used personification. The sun is treated as a human being. The mariner says that the sun now rose out of the sea on the right side of the ship. It was hidden in mist all day. In the evening, it sank into the sea on their left, that is, it set in the west. Stanza 2. And a good south wind still blew behind, but no sweet bird did follow, nor any day for foot or play came to the mariner's hollow. Here the meaning of hollow, an expression of encouragement. The favorable south wind still blew, pushing the ship northward, but the sweet bird that used to come to them every day, either for food or for play with them, was no more to follow them. In the second line of this stanza, the bird has been called sweet because it was an innocent bird of good omen. Sweet also conveys the guilty feeling the ancient mariner finds himself in the killing the bird. He regrets the killing. The fellow sailors call this bird to feed it and to play with it. Many of them were calling it by force of habit, though they knew that it had been killed. Now let us read stanza 3. And I had done a hellish thing, and it would work them woe, for all averred I had killed the bird that made the breeze to blow. Ah, wretched, said they, the bird to slay that made the breeze to blow. Meaning of woe, great unhappiness or sorrow. Meaning of averred, declared. Here in stanza 3, the stanza describes. Please mind here that I in this line is the ancient mariner while they are his fellow sailors. So all the shipmates of the ancient mariner condemned his action of killing the albatross. They said that he had done a devilish thing, that it would bring them misfortune. They said that he had killed the bird of good omen that had caused the favorable wind to blow. They declared the mariner a wretched being for having killed the albatross. The hellish thing done by the mariner in this stanza is that he had killed the albatross, an innocent bird of good omen whose arrival had coincided with the blowing of the south wind. Due to the commission of this hellish thing, their ship got struck in the middle of the hot and sultry silent sea, with no water to drink and no ray of hope to brighten them up. They went through a lot of physical and mental agony. Stanza 4. Not dim nor red, like God's own head, the glorious sun upraised, then all averred I had killed the bird that brought the fog and mist. 'Twas right, said they, such birds to slay that bring the fog and mist. Meaning of upraised, rose up. But now the bright sun rose, neither dim nor red, but luminous and glorious like the hallowed head of God. The sailors declared that the mariner had done the right thing by killing the bird that had brought fog and mist. They said that it was right that such birds that brought fog and mist should be killed. The use of simile in the first line of this stanza is that the round sun looks like the head of God. The sun has been described as glorious because it shines brilliantly. Its brightness stands in contrast to the dullness of the recently spent days. This stanza also shows the two contrary views of the sailors who earlier had condemned the killing of the bird as sinful, but now they approve of it and hold the bird responsible for the fog and the mist. This change of attitude in sailors shows that they are opportunistic and fickle-minded. Their attitude reflects upon the immaturity of their minds. Stanza 5. The fair breeze blew, the white foam flew, the furrow followed three. We were the first that ever burst into that silent sea. Furrow means a trail left by a boat or ship as it moves. Now, a favorable gentle wind blew, the white foam flew off the surface of the ocean. The ship sailed onward calmly and the track made by it was clearly visible. It seemed to them that they were the first people who had ever come to that silent sea. There is a use of alliteration in the first two lines of this stanza. There is a repetition of F and B sounds which creates a musical effect besides conveying the idea of the smooth and swift gliding movement of the sheep, whereas the use of the word furrow illustrates metaphor in this stanza. And the word furrow refers to the splitting of water caused behind a sheep due to its forward movement. The line "the furrow followed Fi" suggests that the sheep sailed on smoothly. Stanza 6. Down dropped the bridge, the sails dropped down. Twas sad as sad could be, and we did speak only to break the silence of the sea. The wind stopped blowing, the sails stood dropped, there was complete silence all around. It was a very sad situation. The eerie silence of the sea was broken only by the sailor's talk. The bridge had stopped blowing because the albatross wrongful killing had begun to show its effect. The ancient mariner and his fellow sailors are about to be punished for the scene. It is to be noted that lines in this para create an atmosphere of eerie silence and absolute inactivity. The atmosphere leaves the sailors full of suspense, fear, and uncertainty. Stanza 7. All in a hot and copper sky, the bloody sun at noon, right up above the mast did stand, no bigger than the moon. The sky looked like heated copper, the sun looked blood red. Even at noon it stood vertically above the mast and looked as small as the moon. Again, there is a use of metaphor in this stanza when the poet says a hot and copper sky and the bloody sun. The sun is blazing red and scorching hot. It is also blood red in color, hence it has been called bloody sun. To the sailors, the harsh weather signifies that they have to face and suffer under this type of weather due to the sin of killing of albatross. It is a part of the punishment they being subjected to. These lines also tell about the location of the ship. The ship is on or near the equator because the sun is very harsh and is at a vertical angle at noon, a phenomenon that occurs in the equatorial region only. We shall read the rest part of the poem in the next class. So thank you, everyone.